star in the cybersecurity world, and it's an absolute pleasure to have you on the show.
Thank you for having me.
It's a real pleasure. Thanks once again for making time.
Sure.
So, you know, we do a ton of consulting and advisory with enterprises, large enterprises globally. These are banks, these are manufacturing organizations. And what really gets me going sometimes is that these same large organizations continue to make the same mistakes over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
We still have a bundle of SQL injections, DDoS attacks, and phishing. What do you think is really the missing piece in the enterprise?
Okay. Well, to put it in one word, it's education.
Okay.
And when you look at every single problem we have, it's either a technical problem or a people problem. And technical problems, they can be hard, but they are fixable. But people problems are hard. All those SQL injections or all those, you know, password leakages, they're done by people errors. I mean, coder makes a mistake.
Right.
People click on the wrong link. And education continues to be probably the hardest challenge we face in computer security. How to get people to learn, how to get people to remember.
So you're saying it's not a technology problem, it's really a people problem in the end.
Well, we have both, but the technological problems are easier.
They're solved, right. Excellent. So, you know, before we move on to the developer issues, let's look at the cyber security landscape. Look,
sure.
Everyone sort of has some sort of API calls these days,
mm-hmm.
has 8 to 10 SaaS applications.
Mm-hmm.
Now, of course, there are dependencies when it comes to developers and who code these applications for you, but as an enterprise, tell me 5 to 6 points as to how should I think about getting started on my cybersecurity landscape? How should I rethink the policies, really?
Well, it starts from doing your threat assessments.
Okay.
Like, you have to understand, like, what is the risk to us? Like, what should we be worrying about?
Mm.
Who are we? What does our company do?
Mm.
What is our core asset? Who are our enemies? Who wants to hurt us?
Right.
Who wants to steal from us? Do we have to worry about foreign nation states? Do we have to worry about organized crime? Do we have to worry about insiders? And the answers to these questions are different for different organizations. And this is where you start from.
Okay.
Because only once you understand who you're trying to fight, who you're trying to prevent from gaining access to your system, then you're equipped to start putting your limited resources and limited budgets into the right place. So that's the first step.
Right. Is it always prevention? Because, you know, a lot of times these days, everybody wants to be the next Uber, right?
Mm.
And they want to participate in the entire API economy.
Mm.
So we see data calls and API calls have really increased.
Sure.
So is it always about the finding the enemy, or is it also finding the partner, the so-called partner who might be out there to hurt you?
Well, we would like to be able to keep everybody out 100% of the time.
Right.
But we can't do it. Nobody can. There's just no fix which would be so complete.
Mm.
And the core problem there is that the attackers are not stupid. And attackers are looking at our solutions. So whatever security solutions we ship, bad people are buying them or downloading them and analyzing them. It's a game of cat and mouse. And this means that it's not good enough to try to keep everybody out all the time. You have to put lots of resources into detecting and responding if they get in. So it's like, I mean, you want to have a lock on your door, but even if you have a lock on your door, it's still a good idea to have a motion detector inside, just
Fair
in
enough.
Case.
Fair enough. Wonderful answer.
Mm.
You know, you spoke about developers, and clearly with so many SaaS applications making their way into the enterprise, per our estimates at Greyhound, we believe 8 to 10 SaaS applications per enterprise is given today. So
mm-hmm.
It's a normal. Now, how do you rethink security? Because ultimately, you can't be 100% sure. Let's take the example of Salesforce.com.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a ton of users who always get impacted by security issues, even though, you know, Salesforce is taking care.
Mm-hmm.
So when, as an organization, I do buy into SaaS,
mm-hmm.
what should be those 3 to 5 things I should look out for
mm-hmm.
when buying SaaS?
Well, I guess the good news is that the largest SaaS providers have top-notch security teams.
Right.
Because obviously, for them, security is paramount. And that actually means that for most organizations, when they move to SaaS services, the security team behind the actual servers is better. Because a single companies, they might have a good security team, but they won't have the scale of security teams the biggest companies, the biggest providers in the world have. So in many ways, you're not only outsourcing your apps and your platforms, you're also outsourcing your security.
Mm-hmm.
That also then has the effect that your files are no longer your files. Your apps are no longer your apps. Your data is being hosted by someone else. And that, of course, means that you have to completely trust your vendors. So choose your vendors carefully.
But, you know, having said that, recently I've been working on some infrastructure and service issues, and a lot of times I see that CIOs sort of completely outsource the responsibility of security. Mm-hmm. Now, having said that, if you think about it, you know, when you're using a lot of cloud, really, you know, you can outsource the fact that someone is having the security, is having the technology, but not the responsibility and the ownership of data. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, they might have the right certifications as well.
Right.
But certifications is once in a year self-certified, right?
Sure.
How do you sort of 365 this ensure there has to be a process and mechanism, right?
Right, right. Well, it becomes a trust issue. You really have to get to know your providers. You really have to understand how they run the technology, what the teams behind these are, and you have to build trust. It doesn't happen overnight. You have to find the right partners, and you, since you know you have to trust them, you have to build the trust. And this is something which cloud providers have been, I've been surprised how well they've been able to bring their products to the market. They've been able to build trust to the largest companies on the planet. So
right.
it is a clear shift happening right now, and okay. it's been a success story.
Okay, so let's change gears. Let's talk about artificial intelligence and machine learning.
Sure.
And that intersection, honestly, is least understood with security.
Mm-hmm.
Can you throw some light on how do these two really intersect?
Well, I think we're a pretty good example of a security company using machine learning, and we've been using it for over 7, maybe 8 years now, for quite a while. And it really is a way for us to handle the large amounts of data we have to analyze. We used to do everything manually. We would get samples and malware and network flows, and we would look at them manually. And the amounts were just too big to handle, so we started automating all this. And in the beginning, we didn't speak about machine learning, we definitely didn't speak about AI. We spoke about labs automation. We were automating the analysts, turning the people's work into a script, which we could then run parallelly. But these things learn. Like, we try to teach our backend systems to tell the difference between a good program and a bad program.
Right.
And you know that's a hard problem.
Yeah.
That's a really hard problem.
Yeah.
But if you have lots of examples of good programs, lots of examples of bad programs, it's something that can be done. And we've been doing it for years and years. It's a narrow example. This is far different from this science fiction artificial intelligence. It's just a set of programs trying to do one thing. But the outcome is that the analyst, our people, analysts, they no longer reverse engineer malware. They teach our system.
Right.
They try to make our learning system learn better.
Okay. So let's say I'm an enterprise who's exploring intersection of AI ML with security.
Mm-hmm.
What are the typical starting points for me? What should be the watch out guards for me?
Yeah, well, there's lots of startups in this space, and there's lots of buzz, there's lots of hype. This is the latest hotness in security, but you really have to drill down, like, what do you actually want? What exactly are these partners providing, and what are these companies promising? We are an example of a company which has been in security business for 30 years,
right.
So we're no newcomers, and sometimes we feel like these completely new startups feel like they know everything in security, and we know they don't know everything, because we've been
sure.
around.
Sure.
So, for a company looking for new solutions,
right.
especially for
right.
in machine learning space, you have to figure out your requirement. Like, what are you trying to solve with these new solutions? Do you have a genuine problem, or are you just believing the sales talks given to you, trying
right.
to convince you
right.
have a problem?
Right.
Security is a specific field. You can drum up all kinds of nasty things, which could happen. But the most important things are the things that really are happening.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where you really should focus
mm-hmm.
first.
Okay. Should I, when we talk of AI and ML, typically every other vendor is talking about scale-out architectures,
sure.
and that's typically CPU, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm of this firm belief that when you're looking at AI, specifically reinforced learning and unsupervised learning, mm-hmm. it's actually GPUs and TPUs
right.
that will come to use.
Uh-huh.
Now, a lot of enterprises still don't understand that.
Mm-hmm.
What's the impact of GPU and TPU usage on security scenarios?
Well, it's true. We use the term old school machine learning for CPU-based
mm-hmm.
mechanisms. There's a clear difference when you get to more
right.
modern systems. But I'm also seeing that a big part of this machine learning system is being outsourced to the cloud. There's these massive back-end systems where you don't have to run any. You don't actually even have to know the mechanics of the cloud. You look at what Google is offering
mm-hmm.
for their machine learning
mm-hmm.
environment. It's a little bit unclear to the end user exactly what the hardware behind all of it, all
Fair
of
enough.
That is. But I guess the crucial point for any company interested or wanting to get into machine learning or use it better in their business is that if you want to teach machines, you have to have stuff for them to learn, which means you have to have data. So even if you're doing nothing else right now, start collecting data.
So that's supervised part of learning,
yes,
right?
Okay. Exactly. And for that, you have to have the data. And even if you're going to start doing it in a year or two, you don't want to start collecting data then. You can start collecting data now, and then you have a much larger data set for supervised learning.
Okay, interesting. Talking about Internet of Things, you know, whether we like it or not, it's infiltrating our lives, sure. Both as a consumer, as an enterprise mm-hmm. as well. And, you know, the fact also is that there is a complete lack of standards.
Sure.
And a lot of innovation is happening with startups, right? Mm-hmm. And that's why the approach to security for IoT has always been sort of Band-Aid. Mm-hmm. You sort of put a Band-Aid and sure. move on. How should that change for enterprises? Because ultimately, you can't have a Band-Aid approach to security mm-hmm. for IoT.
It's a new industry, so it's no wonder there's no standards, there's no regulation. And it's a little bit surprising when you think about it, especially when you think about home appliances,
right.
which is all becoming IoT-enabled right now. Because if you look at washing machine, washing machines have a lot of regulation already. Regulation like electrical safety and fire safety.
Right.
Your washing machine will not catch fire. It will not give you an electric shock, but it will leak your Wi-Fi password. Because there's no regulation on that.
That's right.
So we regulate the safety, but not the security.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure if this is going to change. There's been talk about it in EU and other political
the GDPR
venues.
Entire.
Well, GDPR mentions IoT, but there's no regulation on the actual thing of regulating
right.
IoT security. But there's been talks about that happening.
Yep.
But regulation almost always fails. Mm-hmm. It's a hard thing. I'm not a fan of regulation either. I think what's going to win here is self-certification programs. And,
okay.
and for example, Linux Foundation is, I know they're working on a self-certification system for IoT vendors, and I think they're a pretty good party to do this because almost all of the IoT gear is actually running on Linux kernel in the end when you look
right.
at it.
Right. Okay. My last topic for the day is cyber insurance. And
sure.
I tell you why that really fascinates me is because 9 times out of 10, it's the errors and omissions and the CLIC policies, which are rebranded very casually as cyber insurance policies. But the fact is today, for any organization to run successfully and not be the next Sony or the next Equifax case,
mm-hmm.
Cyber insurance is a must.
Mm-hmm.
But the big question mark is, who underwrites the policy? Who takes care of the costs?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any perspectives on that?
Yeah, we're seeing quite a bit of interest from the largest insurance vendors in the world
mm-hmm.
to get into this business. And it's clear that this market is only in the very beginning. This is going to become the norm, just like we have fire insurances as the norm today. Obviously,
right.
we have. Every
right.
company has fire insurance, and cyber insurance is going to be the same thing in 10, 15, 20 years. But there's a crucial thing here. An insurance company will not sell you a fire insurance unless you make sure you have fire safety in place. They require you to do certain things regarding your fire
right.
safety before they will insure
right.
you. The same thing will apply to cyber insurance. And that's the great thing. Like when you go and buy cyber insurance, okay, then you get insurance for massive data leakage, which is great. But you will also have to jump through hoops to make sure you're good enough to be insured. And that's going to increase your overall security. And that's, I think, the hidden part of the benefits of
okay.
cyber insurance.
My last question for the day will be, you've been a long timer in cybersecurity. You're sort of a historian for the cybersecurity malware, right?
Yes.
If there was one malware you have to identify and say, wow, that was something that shocked you as well, what would that be?
It would be this one right here. I'm an old fart because I carry a floppy with me all
okay.
the time. To remind me of where I'm coming from, I used to carry Brain,
uh-huh.
Brain.a, which is the first PC
right.
virus. I no longer have Brain because I actually tracked down the owners of Brain and I gave
Pakistan.
In Pakistan
That's right,
I gave
yeah.
my Brain.a floppy back to the original owners.
Oh, wow, okay.
I brought it home, so to say. So this isn't Brain, this is Form. Form.a, one of the most common malware, boot sector malware viruses from the 1989-1991 era. And I'm picking this one not just because I have it with me, but also because it really showed us at the time how widespread these things can become.
Right.
Form.a infected computers in every country on the planet. It even infected research computers at the South Pole research
wow.
stations. And this was in 1991.
Back
so,
in time, yeah.
Back in time.
So if there's one thing that really scares Nico in 2018, that would be?
We do these nightmare sessions with fellow researchers.
Okay.
Typically during conferences, we go to the bar, we go to a separate area, we have a beer, and we talk about the worst things that could happen. And you can imagine we can come up with the worst things of worst, really bad stuff.
Right.
But one unwritten rule of these nightmare sessions is that these things that we can come up with are so bad, we don't want to speak about them because we will just give ideas to our enemies, and we don't want to do that. So I'll skip.
Okay, fair enough. Mikko, thank you very much for your time. Been a pleasure hosting you on the show.
Thank you.
And I wish you the very best for 2018.
Thank you.
Thank you.